So, we're going to punch.
Yeah, I'm mostly going to focus on the positioning. So I can do like maybe like 20 crashes just to get that part right. But then I want to really focus on like how you put the elbows right there. Like,
okay. One of the next for recording, one of the next rules after like so you'll have it for reference. Alright, so come on. Actually, you're right. Alright, so keep my chin covered. So first step is to hold the head. I just want to make sure it's hard for you to get away.
Right.
Okay. The next step to making sure you can't get away is touching my shoulder or your forehead.
Right.
Suddenly it's much harder for you to get away. Yeah. So it's definitely a lot harder. I can follow you if you're stronger than me. If you grab me. Yeah. So then what I need to do is put my cheek on your head. I'm going to grab my other arm. Okay, so now it should be very difficult to catch my elbows. Now, the last step is the secret sauce, which is I'm going to bend the base of your neck. Now, that makes it really hard because you're now bent and it's hard to get away. So, from here, it's very, and you can't see what's going on.
Start on crashes.
Okay, sure. Here goes the crashes with one night.
Okay.
Sit down on the front.
Okay, sure.
Maybe you can head, is that better? You want, as I use cheeks, you want as much of your bone structure on the other person's bone structure as possible. I just want as much as I can possibly get on you, because that gives me more control. Dear life.
Right.
That's kind of how you're holding our head.
Okay.
He does not want you to have his head at all.
Okay.
So, alright.
place it.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, there you go. Perfect. Yeah. If you feel that turn, that. Got it.
Maybe it's a good seat. I don't know.
Could be, it does give you more control. Have it on the neck, the less leverage you'll have. As opposed to you.
Ugh.
Okay, it's just that point, you have more leverage.
So,
here. Yeah, there you go, that's better.
Is that low enough?
It was low. I mean, you want it to be as low as possible.
Okay.
It's definitely better.
Because I'm trying to figure out how do you. You can let me know if you notice this channel of mine, but like it seems like the lower you get, the harder it is to get your elbows together. Like, I mean, do you want to play with that and see if that's true? Or like,
I mean, I don't even, maybe that's the truth. I never go up here, so there's not. So, no, I wouldn't know. It's just always right here, and then you get your elbows as close together as possible.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, so. Don't go up there, just go in the car and place and put your elbows as close as you can.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm getting as low as I can, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, it's good. And then set your elbows and then you better.
Like, that's as low as I can get. Look, my elbows still warn you anyway.
Yeah, yeah, that's what you want.
That's as low as I can get, but I mean, if you
that's why you want that Z for me.
Okay, so that's
yeah.
And then,
yeah, there you go, good. So I do it gently, because I know it's going to work. You're used to putting force into it, because sometimes it doesn't work. You have to do it correctly, and, you know, put with as much force as you can.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right. Thanks for tagging too. Right. There you go. All right, so, Z.
Basically doing this as opposed to this.
You just gotta turn a little bit. Turn about 45 degrees also. So you don't do the turn. Because I am told you don't do it.
I mean, okay, yeah, it's just not, for whatever reason, not turning that much. You're doing like this. When you turn it, see how you have more leverage.
Okay,
yeah,
just like rolling your arm over. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, so get it, and then you'll want it. It's all one pulling motion. It will feel like rolling, but you just pull on a certain. Turning like this. You're turning again like a steering wheel, like your head is a steering wheel and you're going like this. the steering wheel is actually going vertical. That's the steering wheel. Okay?
It's the steering wheel is going this way, it's not going this way. So it's
going diagonally this way.
Oh, diagonally.
It's going basically from like shoulder to head.
Would you call it clockwise or counterclockwise? Like?
Clockwise.
So shoulder to head clockwise. So
yeah.
Z. Z.
You're too high is the problem. Here's why things are working. You're too high. You need to be down here and then do that circle there. It's you're going down like towards your head.
Rotating my left hand to this hip.
Yeah. From the base of the hip.
Okay. So, how low is that feeling you like?
I mean, that's pretty good.
It's like if I get even lower, like my elbows will be up.
Okay.
So I'm saying, like,
it doesn't have to be low right away. Like, I don't put it around. Like, I just hook here. Here, all I'm doing is hooking. And here, I'm still only hooked. It's just when I come to here. Even then, I haven't done it yet. At this point, I'm just holding the neck normally with my elbows in the right place. From here, now I'm going to go down.
Okay?
And to the hip. So I don't even worry about how low it is until my hand is on the right hand. Just get the hump. All you're doing is getting the hump. And all you're doing is getting the shoulder. All you're doing is gripping, and then all you're doing is going down in a direction. You're not ever worrying about how low it is. It's just, at the very last motion, you're going down, so it's going to get that up.
Okay.
So, don't worry about just hook. And, like, everything is right so far. You just have to make sure you're hooking a few circles in the right direction. And that is not, it's got to be like this. That's close. There you go, that's close.
Is that
yeah, that's pretty close. I'm not pulling so much turning. More pulling, still turning a little. There we go, pretty good.
That's pretty close right there.
That's the closest so far. So you just got to pull this vertebra. To your hip. That's it. Like from here, all I'm doing is taking that vertebra and putting it toward my hip. That's it.
Is it?
Yeah.
The part.
Yeah. Yeah, the other hip.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And you're doing, you're pulling it to the left toward the opposite. Just, if you just do that, that should do everything right. Yeah, that's pretty close. Not that, just that one. Yeah, that's pretty good.
Alright.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, haven't you stayed practice on getting a feel for it?
Yeah, I definitely read, like, someone's name.
Yeah, and, like, even just find someone and be like, hey, I've got this technique, why don't we go for it? And then you'll hold that on the right side.
Next spar.
Sure, yeah. What else do you want to work on? Usually we do spar blocks. Power punching, kicking.
Do we convert to kick this?
Sure, yeah. You want to, and also there's the dealing with kicks. Like basically whatever you want recorded, we can do.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we can go ahead and kick out as well. Yeah, you can go to kicks like probably faster.
Okay,
so
we'll
kick
counters.
We'll do fast, yeah.
Start off a little slowly.
Sure, I'll just avoid the mid point kick. I mean, that's the easiest one anyway. Other than the left one. But yeah, I want to get better. Ooh. Generally, you have the technique down. Just try to hook that more out of the way. And use it.
And that was the other one. And that is this.
Okay. Because
you realize the limitation that like, even that pull doesn't work very well.
Okay. Alright. Well, why don't we stop doing it? I just want to do a few more. You should do a few. Only should do a few more on that. On that other side.
Yeah, that's good.
I don't call it a day. Yeah. On that. We'll just do a few. Cool. And actually, that's one of the things I wanted to work on with this. Make sure that when you hook it, it actually gets a hook and like moves me that way a little bit. So, yeah, but not up necessarily. Go ahead and throw the rear kick. See how I don't necessarily want to pull it or move it up. I just want you to like. I just want to get that out of here like this. You didn't expect to still be going forward. You know, you don't have to pull up. Just kind of let it go to the side and continue going in that direction. Just let it keep going in the direction I wanted to go in anyway. Yeah, exactly. There you go. And
do you still sit there? That's it. Or is that it?
You don't have to pivot.
I don't have to be something to do with it.
Well, no, because you can't counterattack.
Okay.
So you should, what it's really realistically look like, if I'm going to give you that kick, it should be this. Okay? You want to make it so they can't get away from you. Remember, you only want to do high commitment punches if they can't get away for some reason.
Right?
So, and the way you can make sure they can't get away is by getting this up. So, do that, swoop it aside, have this already coming in, and then drop the foot and throw the punch. They are not going to be able to hit you with any kind of power with their foot up in the air like this. Even if they're swinging their hands, it's not going to do anything. Yeah, just get out of the way. Don't commit this big motion to your arm. Go ahead and throw that kick in here. That's all we want. We just want it to be, as soon as it goes by, you're right back to here. And you're doing this at the same time, so this comes back. So this hand's just going to look like here, here. And you just have another left punch, or lead punch, before that, just getting to it. Yeah, there you go, that's it. And it's very quick and short. All these things should seem very short and simple, because those are the things that are the hardest to counter. Part of the counter, and the least commitment on your part. Like, for the commitment that other people would do to get one punch, you just had two punches in that were undefendable.
You're so far over that I can't even hit you. Like you're like,
if I'm too close, then just throw the hook. Or the straight. I mean, you could throw a straight from right here and do a lot of damage. Like, if I throw this right here, I promise that's going to do a lot of damage. So don't worry about being too close.
Okay.
Yeah. Being too close is rarely a problem. Could do power punch and power kicking, and/or power kicking. You can arrange the bar and whatever.
Let's do the power punch.
Okay. If you want to do power punching, you have to put your grab on.
Okay, so to start off nice and easy.
And since we're recording, I'll just explain from the beginning.
Sure. Let's do it.
Alright, so with every motion in sports that requires power, you have to do two things. Step and twist. Throw a football, you step and twist. Throw a baseball, you step and twist. Stepping and twisting is how human beings generate force. So when you throw a punch, it's the same thing. So you're going to step, and your hips, another way of saying this is your hips have to be moving forward and twisting at the same time. Even if you have no leg and you just hover in the air, you can generate the same force by moving forward and twisting. So if you move forward, twist, and just like you're swinging a baseball bat, at the right time, you swing. So step, twist, and you should feel that weight. And importantly, your hips should make contact while your hips are still moving. You can't, like when you throw a football, you don't make the hip motion and then throw with your arm. You release the football while your hips are still moving. Same thing. You have to make contact while your hips are still moving. Moving, it's forward and twisting. You want to do this at the same time. So forward and twist, and during like the best window for that forward and twist, you're making contact. That will allow you to use your feet to punch with. Okay, so just start off nice and easy, and then just build up as you come up. Forward motion doesn't stop for the cross. You're kind of doing forward motion for the jab and then turning for the cross. The jab is really not your power punch. So it needs to be just jab. I usually jab when I'm stepping out before I even move my hips. So it's jab, and then, because that's why we usually, when we practice, we start with just step, just cross and no jab. Because this, the jab is not on the step board. The jab is like before the step where right when it's starting. And then once the jab is done, you see how it's all at the same time?
Yeah.
All that happens at the same time. So it's like jab, and you're still like in this, not, you have to put your weight down, you have to move your weight down. And then all this stuff happens at once. Boom! All at once. Okay, that's why you feel weight. Because it's bang, boom, and then all that happens.
I just worked across the road.
Yeah, that's okay, that's good. Yeah. That'll be a good way to start. And then you just throw it, you just add the jab in later.
Okay.
You just add it in, and it's not part of the step twist. Okay. Just all that jab at the same time. So moving your hips forward, turning your hips, and landing the punch all happen at the same time.
There you go, good.
And it's just like a baseball bat. Yeah. A little tight of later on the punch. And likewise, like when you start swinging the bat, you don't want to swing a little early. There's like an optimal time right there toward the end. It's like 3/4 of the way through the motion that you cut the most force. Yeah, that actually was good firing. That was pretty good. It was a little off center, but that's not bad. So get a little wind up first. Wind up, like when you get a football, you don't, if you're watch this closely. When you throw the football, you don't, see, watch my shoulder. You don't throw it like this. Okay? This is not how you throw it. When you throw football, see if you lead with your chest. See how my arm is flexing back a little bit? And then you whip it forward. Same thing with a punch. You don't do this with a punch, for optimal force. You step, you don't bring your hand back. You step, twist, and it's like you're pointing up your shoulder. So I don't have my wraps on, but it's like the punch whips out at the last second. That and you're
but using one just sort of to turn it back though.
And that happens naturally with the jab.
Right.
With the jab, you naturally bring that shoulder back a little bit. Yeah, you naturally have some of this waving motion. You don't throw your punches like this. There's naturally a little bit of this is like if you can land one of them, that'll be fine. The reason people don't end fights with crosses usually is because they're just throwing with their arm muscles, and that's it. There's no weight behind it. So it kind of like hurts, but there's no, you don't move the head. It's moving the head that knocks somebody out. Like moving that plexus at the base of the neck. Like if you just hit someone, it's not going to knock them out. You have to actually move your head. That's why we're doing this. That's good timing. Think of it as you're putting the mark down where you're at, like you're feeling where you're at. That's good. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, people are not going to expect you to be able to mark that. Yeah. interrupt on anyone.
One more thing.
Sure.
When we were doing the power hooks, mm-hmm. the ideas I had is that I'm probably going to be going them as I'm in the corner, or I have in the corner.
Probably, usually.
So, that's why I was, I know you can't step in the corner, though. You can't. So you're making that more compact motion, and that's what I'm thinking, right? Would you agree with that or not?
Yeah, you don't take a big step. The step is always adjustable to how much you need. So
if you guys need a corner.
See, I you can still step. I just still step with 15 inches.
So
like if you're here, you still have to move your body to the floor. Mm. So you're still gonna be going back and forth.
But see how you're moving forward, like you would just kind of naturally be moving in.
Yeah, mostly lateral. But I mean, how many times are you gonna punch him in the corner? He's gonna fall down. Like I've never had to step forward more than a couple times.
Yeah. I guess I'm just trying to get a feel for like if say I do end up going like 8 to 10 punches with the uppercuts and everything, how those steps would go without me.
Just go back and forth. Just go back sideways back and forth.
Sideways.
Yeah, just theoretically you shouldn't have to punch that many times. But if you've got someone in the corner and they can't move and you're throwing these bobs, you're just gonna move mostly side to side. You can just stay in that optimal zone.
Got it, okay, so it's side.
Yeah, you're still stepping and twisting. You always step and twist. There's always, your hips always have to move in those two axes. They have to move, I don't know how to call it, either on a plane, and they also have to turn on a plane.
Would it make sure I had those right?
Sure.
Just to listen up, that's an hour of rubber door in here.
Okay, that's just another hook.
Up.
It doesn't matter. Okay. Like again, it's just another angle. Close. See, you want to.
That's not number one.
Okay, you want. You have to turn through. That's better. You're hitting them with your hips and your legs. Don't be afraid to turn a little bit more, especially on them. Yeah. You're already committing a lot anyway, like turning on it at all. Pretty good.
So if you want my other one, I'm gonna grab my clothes. What you work out with us?
Sure.
So
I want to put
my
hand.
I said we're both up really. I mean I can go. It does look like you're right.
Okay. Yeah, so now your arm covers.
Okay, so now you were saying that it should be like already structured to wrap going, so
see, the thing is, you're not going to throw an uppercut. You don't throw an uppercut from right here. Like, if we're fighting, I'm not going to throw an uppercut from here.
Right.
I'm only going to throw, like, if I come to here, now I can throw an uppercut.
Oh, after.
Because I'm already here. Yeah.
After uppercut.
Yeah. You're not going to throw, like, jab, uppercut. That doesn't ever usually actually happen in my life. Like, you're not going to go to jab and then uppercut. It wouldn't make a lot of sense to do that. Because with the jab cross, you get a twisting motion. Jab cross. So it naturally leads to a hook. That's why jab cross hook is a combination.
Yeah.
And usually jab cross uppercut is not usually a combination. Because you're turning anyway. So it's easy to add in an uppercut. Now, if I go back this way and I change the direction a little bit, I can never change the direction again. Okay? So you don't want to change your angle too much on anyone. Generally speaking, of course, rolls are maybe broken, but just in general, boom, 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 and then I'm already up over here and down a little bit, so I can come up for an uppercut. And then I'm already up a little bit, so it comes down for an overhand. So, you want to make it natural for you. So, because you're already going to be there, you don't want to have to change your momentum. You want to use the momentum you already have. So I would say if you're just using that one hand, you're just going to have to turn back to that. If you're
the hook here is pretty fucking good at uppercut, so that goes.
Okay.
So I can do hook uppercut.
That's fine. And why don't you, I'm going to get one of these. And you can just go easy on it. Like, that's your arm.
Yeah.
So we'll just go kind of on one here. And then uppercut.
Still make sure the weight is nice, so.
Yeah, there you go. See, that's a good combination of practice.
Make sure my feet are right.
That's one that's not usually practiced that much, but that's good because if you throw here, they're usually not going to expect the uppercut. Usually, if they're in the corner, they're usually not going to expect that. If they cover up, they're going to cover up four hooks.
Yeah.
They're not going to usually cover up for the following uppercut.
Yeah. You have complained about my hand posture, so I guess I got those right then.
Yeah, those are pretty good. Sparring, because nothing that he did was about sparring. He was not. I would not be surprised. I don't know. Don't quote me on this. I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't even spar that much. Like if it was all, I would not be surprised if I heard that his regimen was all about power, angle, momentum, good footwork, and stuff like that. And there wasn't actually a whole lot of just light sparring. Because none of his strengths were related to light sparring. Yeah, it's really good. I would say the next step for you is to make it smoother and faster. Because you're doing it a little robotically, which is fine when you start, but make it a little smoother and faster without stopping.
Or making sure do you need to use some check the power of weight that you're faster?
What?
Do you need to use some check that the weight bracket?
Sure.
And maybe some stepping into the weight.
Right? Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. That would definitely be a good thing for you to practice. Super basic, but you have to do all these advanced things that we're doing at the same time. Start off slowly. So this is just jab cross. Yeah, exactly. And you have to actually do it correctly as opposed to the way most people do. Alright, there you go. See, this was really stretchy. Your
Yeah. It's that's another factor in that skill.
And if you're going to see,
like the issue is when if he's going to start swaying too, and your hand is down at that key time, just he could randomly just knock you out. So just, but if your hand's there, he won't knock you out. Just have your hand there when you're not punching. Just get used to bang, like where your other hand is always up.
Into the corner type of thing, like
right, yeah, yeah.
Into the corner.
All right, so kicks, you can leave your gloves on or take them off. All right. Okay, so I'll explain this. All right, so it's the exact same motion where you step and twist. It's a little harder because you have to do part of it on one leg. So, as opposed to punching where you have your legs on the ground pretty much the whole time.
Yeah.
When you kick, you have to do the same thing, but you also have to lift one of your legs off the ground. So, now remember, it's not about the legs, really, it's about the hips. So, you still have this moving, twisting at the same time, connecting while you're moving and twisting at the same time. That whole concept, except now you have to do with your legs. So, step, and then while you're twisting, you're connecting the top half of your shin with whatever you're, so, and you have to feel that weight behind you. You don't even need that much power in your buckles on the leg with you. If your hip is moving in those two axes, when the kick makes contact with the top of your shin, not necessarily because the top of the shin is harder, which it is, but the real reason is because you have more leverage. It's like cutting with the short part of the scissors has more power than the tip of the scissors because of leverage. So in order to get more leverage out of your power generating, you want to kick kind of as high up close to your knee as possible.
Okay.
What do I take with?
Excalibur, right?
Okay. Stepping, moving your hip, and then twisting and kicking. That's the order of doing things in curl. You're stepping, moving your hip, and then twist, kicking at the right time. The problem is, you have to also be moving forward when you're kicking. So the difference is, hands up. So the difference is between step, move hip, twist and kick, versus step, twist and kick. And you can feel how there's so much more weight there. You can feel the weight. You can feel just this right here. Like this motion. There's just that much more. However much this weighs is added on to the kick into that little space. So it's like all this weight times, you know, this amount of surface area. So just be moving when the kick makes contact. And it's like, you know, you have to commit to it. It's like, you can't, like, the reason people don't do this is because they don't like the non-safety of committing to a kick. So, they'll sit here and they'll just, like, slap with their leg and, you know, it's easy to get the twist part because you kind of have to twist to get the leg out there.
Yeah.
But moving your hip also, it would be like if someone was swinging a baseball bat and they were just, like, doing this because they don't want to, like, commit to it. And even if they're twisting and doing that, it's not going to, the ball's not going to go anywhere. You watch baseball players, and when they swing, they really commit to the swing. And it's like, if they miss, they might swing all the way through.
Right?
So you have to commit to the leg, or it's not worth throwing it.
like, you might as well punch. Because you have, you can do it faster, it's less metal, and it does the same amount of damage as a kick that you're not committing to. Alright, so, commit to the kick. If you overcommit to it, it's fine, you can always back off. Do the hard part. If there's something that's hard, do that too much, because you can always back off of that. That's better. Yeah, good. So think like you're gonna almost like aim and push through the thigh. Like you're gonna lay all your weight and just drop all your weight on the thigh.
And then so you do have to keep coming down to the side.
It doesn't matter. Anything you hit with that is just gonna break. You can go up, side. Now, to answer your question, geometrically, what you wanna do is have a perfect parallel angle with the surface. So what that means is the leg is usually slightly angled out a little bit, so you want to be slightly angled down a little bit for maximum force. So that answers your question, but kind of the more rubber to the road answer is just kick it correctly and it won't matter what angle you're hitting at. Second pad.
If I have to get a second pad, that means you're doing it right.
Get to the point where just whatever you kick is going to break. If you get it exactly, if you get it just right, if you kick like the side of the calf or this, or if they do their arm and you kick your arm, you know.
Even with shin guards?
Well, who's wearing shin guards? You're not going to wear shin guards, you're a fighter, right? They wear shin guards in fights? Kickboxing?
But not professional fans.
Okay. I don't know. I've never worn kickboxing shins in a fight. So I don't know how that works. But anyway, just work on the...
You can like division A and B, like if you don't wear shins.
Okay. No, I don't think I've ever worn shins.
I think that's...
That was back in the old days. You could do it.
Right, back in the old days.
You could bring your dinosaur into the
type. Right, that's the same. Kumite, Kumite type stuff.
That's it. Yeah. Okay, all right. So, what's the next...
Sparring.
Okay. Right. Okay. Should be fine.